and welcome to the fourth episode of my Forensic Friday series, a series where I talk through different aspects of forensics and crime scene investigation. This video is going to be about forensic photography, crime scene photography, the photos that are taken when somebody first arrives at a crime scene. So the photos and videos that are taken of the crime scene are used for documentation. They're used to remind people what the crime scene looked like. So these can be for investigators, they can be used in court. All of these photos are taken as you arrive at the crime scene, of the scene in its original state. Similar to the notes I spoke about in my documentation video, which I will link somewhere, the photography itself also has contemporaneous notes. So this means that each photo that is taken is numbered and then described what exactly the photo is of. The crime scene photos must also include environment photos. So this can be photos of the front of the house, for example. It could include the path leading up to the house. It could include the road that runs next to it. As I also mentioned in my first Forensic Friday, you can also take photos of the cap or the common approach path. When taking the photographs in a room, you have to make sure that there is no equipment that the CSIs have brought or any people in the photo. So for example, if you're taking the room shots of a photo, make sure you don't get any people in mirrors or in the reflection in windows. If there's a footprint that needs its photo taken, you must use a scale or an L-shaped ruler to show exactly how big it is. And all of these photos have to be taken parallel, so the camera is not throwing off the scale in any way. Now for scenes where there is a body, there must be photos taken of the body itself in the room to show where it was, and then close-up photos taken of the injuries themselves. After the body's been taken by the coroner or the ambulance services, for example, there must be photos taken of where the body was lying. This is to show the area around it and underneath it. So for the actual photos that have to be taken of a specific room, it usually starts with photos from each four corners so that you can show a basic map of what the room looks like from each different perspective. Then you would take long-range photos of each piece of evidence. So you would take what is called an in-situ photo, which basically shows where that piece of evidence is in comparison to the pieces of furniture or the entrances and exits to the room. These are then followed by mid-range and close-range photos of each piece of evidence. So I made a mock-up crime scene in my bedroom earlier. It's kind of a morbid room tour, if you like. The scenario goes, somebody's broken into the house and somebody in the house has found the suspect in the kitchen. So the suspect grabs the nearest weapon object near them. It happens to be a kitchen knife because that seemed appropriate. They've run into this room, followed by the homeowner, and the suspect has lashed out, stabbed the homeowner, causing blood spatter up one side of the wall. They've discarded the knife on the side, tried to wipe the blood off their hand, and then stepped back through the blood, made their way out over the desk, causing a footprint on the desk, unlatched the window and climbed out that way. So as you can see from the photos I've taken of the room, I've got the aspect photos, so each four corners have been photographed. Then we've also got the in situ photos of each piece of evidence, so showing where they are in the room. And then we have the mid-range and the close-range photos of the spatter, the knife itself, the footprint, and the fingerprints. As you can see, the photos with the footprint are all using the L-shaped scale I mentioned earlier. This, of course, is a perfect kind of scenario for a CSI. You've got the blood spatter, which could indicate whereabouts the person was stabbed. You've got the weapon itself, which will have fingerprints on it. You've got the blood smear, which could perhaps even bring up DNA from the suspect where they've scraped their fingers on the cupboard, for example. You've got a footprint, and you've also got where the window latch has been opened, fingerprints on the window. All of these photographs can be used in court and they can be used by the investigators to create an image of the crime scene. So that is why we use crime scene photography and the methods we use to do it. I hope this video has been informative. If you have any more questions, don't be afraid to leave them in the comments and I will do my best to try and answer them. Also, let me know if there's anything specific you would like me to cover in these videos. I would be really interested to see what you would like to hear about. Thank you for watching and I will see you in my next video.